No, lust allures different people differently. Within lust allures men with pleasure. And pleasure means men desire women. The desire for having a woman, for enjoying with a woman. That is the basically the physical form of a woman. That's what a man is attracted to. In contrast, what are women? Women also, lust is not, women not free from lust. But how lust attracts women or lust captivates women is that women desire the desire of men. So desire, if I can just remove for from both, it might become women desire, men desire women, and women desire the desire of men. Now, what this means is that I put over here also that there is the men are allured by pleasure through lust, and women are allured through power. Allured through power means that it is a heady sense of power for a woman to see that, okay, I'm able to attract so many men or attract such a powerful man. If somebody enters into a room and everybody stops doing whatever they are doing and looks at that person, it is a titillating sensation, and especially when a woman is young and attractive, and every young woman is by nature given some attractiveness, and some women are of course much more attractive than others, and that has its power. So everybody has to deal with lust in their own ways, and say men are, you know, you have to regulate the desire for men, and women have to regulate the desire for the desire of men. That means women are told that, especially after marriage, don't dress very attractively to parade to the whole world. Dress in a chaste way. So why is that? Because now that is the way in which, say, desire manifests. Male and female psychology are different. And for a woman, this the desire for the desire of man is the way lust allures. In fact, there are many significant ways in which this plays out in the modern world also, even if you call it the postmodern world. The postmodern, today's world has placed many challenges before us. Now, sometimes this is not a very palatable subject to talk about, but it's in some ways relevant to our topic, that porn is a big problem in today's world. And in some ways, this problem illustrates how our technology has become too strong for our morality. Our technology has become too strong for our morality, because the temptation is available just by clicking a few buttons. And in today's world, people can see more obscenity in 5 minutes than what maybe 50 years ago, even 50 years ago, people could have seen an entire lifetime. So the temptation available is overwhelming. So if we consider our morality like our weightlifting capacity, and the technology, temptations coming from technology are like a heavy weight. So what has happened is that technology has grown too fast for our morality to keep pace. And millions of people fall prey to this. And there may be very good people who fall prey to it also, in the sense that normally behave in very responsible, respectable ways. According to some surveys, around 78% of people in the world succumb to this. It's difficult to, first of all, to define what is porn. Secondly, decide what is, at what level is one considered to be like a regular user or addict. But the point I'm making is slightly different. I'm not going to go into porn. I'm going to talk here about how men and women, the psychology works differently. So usually porn is thought of as a male problem. But there is another kind of genre which attracts women, which has now been called as pormance. Romance novels is like romance novels which have a lot of obscene content in them. And these have huge sales. In fact, one of the best-selling authors in this romance genre, when she published her first novel, for 1.5 years, she got, it was only an ebook. And for 1.5 years, every month, she was earning $400,000 per month in royalty. So millions of literally millions and millions of books are sold, and the consumers of these kind of books are primarily women. So men are attracted more visually, so that's why porn is visual. But women are attracted more verbally, to words and description in words. And if you look at these novels, I mean, you don't have to look at them. But the point is that I read some articles about them, and they are about quite a bit about sexual aggressiveness. It features men who are quite aggressive. So now what happens is, it's people find it titillating, women find it titillating. Why? Because this is, as I said, women desire the desire of men. So if a man is so aggressive in his desire for a woman, not aggressive in the sense of being abusive or violent, but aggressive within the context of affection, then that captivates. So you know, the detail that is overlooked in the many detailings of the Ramayana, of this Ahalya story, that lust allures different people, that Ahalya knew that it was Indra. That is a significant detail. It's not just passing information. So there are people who are actually psychologists who treat, is that there is porn addiction is a recognized form of addiction, and people, there are ways to treat that. But the psychologists are saying that we need to also have something like a poor man's addiction. That now what happens is, if somebody is looking at visual obscenity, it seems obscene, clearly. But if somebody is just reading a romance novel, now, of course, romance novel is a very big genre. And sometimes there are books which may be just about a romantic story without much sexuality in it. But they are the exception, not the norm. So people get hooked onto these books, and then primarily women again, and their mind become filled with all kinds of fantasies, and it has consequences also. So the idea is that rather than thinking of lust as a problem among males who are victimizing women, rather we need to see that lust is a common problem that males and women, females both face. That's what Krishna says. Iha vairinam kamesha krodesha rajoguna samudbhava mahashano mahapapma vidye enam yadvairinam. That is the enemy of humanity. Iha refers to everyone in this world. Mahashano mahapapma. It's the all-devouring sinful enemy of the whole world. And if you look at the Mahabharata, at one level, Ravan is the embodiment of lust. That's true. But if you look at the whole story, what inflames it is, or what triggers the story, is not just Ravana's lust for Sita. It is also Shurpanakha's lust for Ram. And because she's scorned, because she's rejected, so then she manipulates and schemes. And he says, okay, Sita came in my way. I will destroy Sita. And how will I destroy Sita? By having her abducted by, taken. If I can't enjoy Ram, then no one will be able to enjoy. Even Sita should not be able to enjoy Ram. So what will happen? It is she who instigates Ravan to abduct Sita. Now, of course, we can't say that Ravan is innocent. No, Ravan is, of course, definitely has, he is the embodiment of lust, as I mentioned. But in this particular narrative, Ravana's lust is triggered by Sita. Initially, when Ravan hears about what has happened, he's angry. But when he hears it's Ram, he decides not to do anything, because he's heard from his military generals, from Maricha specifically, that it's a complicated storyline, and I won't go into detail again, but suffice it to say that, see, first, events are that Shurpanakha tries to allure Ram and Ram refuses, and then she tries to attack Sita, and then she is punished for that. Then she goes to her brothers Karan Dushan, and they attack Ram, and Ram kills all of them single-handedly, and then one general, Akampan, survives. His name is Akampan, but he is doing all Kampan. He's trembling and he runs away and tells Ravan what has happened. And at that time, Akampan gives the idea to Ravan, don't attack Ram directly. It seems that Ram must be very attached to his wife. That's why he's brought his wife to the forest. Now, demons can only think in terms of the negatives. They can't think in terms of commitment and service. Ram must be wanting to enjoy Sita. That's why he wants her to be with him. And that's why he's brought her to the forest. So, but he can't think in terms of that Sita is committed. Sita wants to be with Ram. She has a sense of commitment and duty.